The courage and strength are the less fortunate increase when people show love and care, giving them the tools to realize a better quality of life. It's the reason for the season. Hi there, welcome to another edition of Jamaica Magazine. I'm Adrian Atkinson. On the pages today, we'll be celebrating the spirit of the season, but still make room for a cautionary word about the dangers of alcohol abuse in all the merrymaking. Also, reach out and touch this festive season to spread the joy of caring and the gift of sharing. Plus, keeping safe on our roads. All these and more to come as we turn the pages of the magazine. Stay with us.
The Ebola virus is transmitted through direct contact with an infected person's blood or other bodily fluids like saliva, urine, stool, and semen. Symptoms of Ebola include sudden fever, intense weakness, muscle pain, headache, and sore throat. This may be followed by vomiting, diarrhea, and rash, and in some cases, both internal and external bleeding leading to death. Protect yourself. Avoid travel to Ebola-affected countries. Avoid contact with infected persons. Don't touch the body of someone who has died from Ebola. Wash hands frequently with soap and water and use an alcohol-based hand sanitizer. To know more, call 1-888-663-5683.
It is with clear insight that the government is working to develop an alcohol policy that will tackle irresponsible alcohol use and hopefully reduce negative consequences such as illnesses and road accidents. As we take time out to celebrate during Christmas and the New Year, let's all be conscious of the dangers of alcohol abuse.
It has been 38 years. And I still have pains every day.
From that time until now, I'm still having pains.
Every year, hundreds of Jamaicans, like Marlene Walker-Wilson and Eileen Barnes, are injured in road crashes caused by drivers under the influence of alcohol. Drivers who may not be drunk, but who have enough alcohol in their system to dull their senses.
As you increase the level of alcohol, it depresses your ability to function. And as far as driving is concerned, the thing that we are focusing on mostly, it impairs your judgment. It affects your ability to make decisions, whether you should overtake or not, when you should overtake. It affects your reaction time. If a vehicle is coming at you, it affects your ability to react at a particular time. It affects the time that you take to depress the brake, to stop, and it affects your vision. You can't see as well if your alcohol level is too high.
It's for these reasons that Jamaica and other countries have put limits on how much alcohol a driver should have in his or her system.
We in Jamaica now, along with many other countries, are at 0.08 limits. The European countries have reduced it to 0.05, and I think America is going to follow suit. The reason being is that at zero alcohol levels, your ability to concentrate is 100%. As you increase it by even 0.01, 0.02, every single digit of increase, even at lower levels, increase your risk of being involved in a crash.
So if the legal limit is 0.08, in real terms, how much alcohol are we talking about?
We're talking about one beer, we're talking about a glass of wine, we're talking about one drink of rum. But it depends a lot on your metabolism.
How fast your body uses fuel, how your body deals with alcohol. It also depends on how much food you have in your stomach, how healthy you are, and how tired you are.
There are so many variables. And that's why, rather than deal with the technical things, we just say don't drink and drive.
About drinking responsibly.
When you drink with your friends at a party and you tell somebody else to drive, so you have a designated driver. That is the essence of responsible drinking. Responsible drinking don't mean that you can drink a small amount and go and drive. It means that if five or six of you go to a party, one is designated as the driver, and that person does not drink any alcohol whatsoever, and the others can have a good time.
Besides the increased risk of a collision, serious injuries and even death, there are other reasons drivers should avoid drinking. The long arm of the law.
The Jamaica Constabulary Force has been stepping up its breath testing effort with a view to reducing the number of persons driving under the influence.
We have what is known as our traffic ban policy operations, and this of course occurs from Thursday to Sunday to Monday morning of every week. And what we do, we ensure that we are present on the arterial and main road areas leading from entertainment venues and where people drink too much. Mm-hmm. And we encourage people to have their designated driver once they decide to, you know, have a few drinks. Mm-hmm.
In addition to alcohol, doctors advise drivers to stay away from other mind-altering substances such as some prescription drugs and narcotics like marijuana.
In fact, there was a study done by Professor McDonald at the university many years ago. And the study found that a significant number of people were involved in crashes at the university hospital had marijuana in their system.
The Road Safety Unit in the Ministry of Transport and Works, the National Road Safety Council, and the police are urging drivers to be more responsible.
In the same way that a diabetic has to be very careful what he or she eats, you have to look at the label, you have to ask questions. The same way that if you're a responsible person and you are going to be driving, you have to be very careful what you're drinking.
And look out for other road users, drivers and pedestrians.
You need to realize that when you put yourself behind a wheel, it's a very dangerous instrument.
After 24 years, I'm still trying to cope with it.
If you have to drink alcohol, don't go behind a steering wheel.
Know your numbers and control the keys to a healthier heart. Know the numbers for your blood pressure, cholesterol level, blood glucose level, and your weight and body mass index. Find out the risks they represent and what you need to do to stay healthy. Talk to your doctor and start making healthy lifestyle choices to prevent a heart attack or stroke.
One of the most anticipated activities of the Christmas season is the joy of giving and receiving. However small or large, in cash or kind, words or deeds, making the connections, the cheerful approvals, and the heartfelt satisfaction of being there to reach out to someone in need.
Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place if you can.
The eyesore of a community gets tidy because citizens feel they have a responsibility to act. A building gets a well-needed facelift and gifts for those in need. At-risk youth benefiting from academic and skills training, while poor performance gets tackled through extra lessons. All through the efforts of generous hearts, making tangible contributions and creating positive change. It's all part of nation building, inspiring hope, and rewarding oneself with the joy of sharing with other people. And what better time is there than now?
I've been thinking lately, and I think you should give it some thought too. The development of my community needs my input. But where do I start?
The very first place that I would encourage anybody who wants to be a part of the community, who wants to resolve to be active in their community, is to be a part of a community-based organization.
I firmly believe that participation is important to the development process. Action at all levels, all age groups, for deeds, not just words, get the job done. Communities need the participation of its able citizens to do something to create positive change. Do you agree? What can we do? Volunteer, share good ideas, help fix a problem, show love, show that we care, if that's all we can do. So much to complain about, things not being done, the things we need for ourselves, for our communities, the plight of the less fortunate.
I tell people all the time that I think Jesus was a community development officer because you don't see Jesus in the church every day sitting down, worshiping. You see Jesus in the streets, in the communities, right? So even in churches, be a part of the outreach groups in your church.
Where I live should be the best place to live. So issues such as roads, housing, water, sanitation, crime, unemployment, and training is of concern to me. And it should be of concern to you too. Now is as good a time as any to give a helping hand through greater community participation. And I therefore resolve to do more to help. You should too. As a citizen, I know what's best for my community, the real needs. And waiting on governments to make decisions and effect change for me is not something that I'm inclined to do. I am subscribing to the idea of community self-help. The thing is, my participation, as well as yours, can help to solve our problems. But it will mean getting involved in a more organized way.
Under the local government reform process, the SDC has been very instrumental in setting up community development committees. These are umbrella organizations that captures the community-based organizations in the community. Then it provides an excellent opportunity to deal with the issues firsthand.
Together we can plan and implement projects using our expertise and resources to develop our community. While I make my resolve to be more active, why not join me? There are no age or gender limits for the willing and able. The various community projects and services that we'll have to carry out requires not only our time and expertise, but also funding. And here, the Social Development Commission comes in handy. Getting formal development plans in place and helping with accessing financing through the Jamaica Social Investment Fund and other donors.
There are strength in numbers, so when a group represents a major concern or a minor concern within the community, you find that they will be heard on not just from the end of the government, but from non-government organizations, businesses.
So much we can do, starting in our own backyard, then join others to work on issues we care about. Less hoping, less watching, less despairing, more doing.
It is the festive season and we all want to enjoy ourselves. So if you drink, don't drive. And if you drive, please drive within the speed limit and obey all the road codes. If you have an hypertensive patient or a diabetic patient, stick with your diet. As I said, do everything in moderation, don't overindulge. And if we all do that, we will have an enjoyable holiday.
Pedestrians are at risk of serious injuries and even being killed by accidents on the roads. But by practicing good road safety measures and not depending on motorists or other users for protection, the number of fatalities can be cut. More on pedestrian safety in this next feature.
Pedestrians are among the most vulnerable groups of road users. Traditionally, pedestrians, along with pedal cyclists and motorcyclists, have ranked high on the road fatalities list. When a pedestrian is hit by a motor vehicle, the impact and severity of injury is determined by a number of factors: the size of the vehicle, the speed at which it is traveling,
the angle at which impact was made with the individual, as well as what happened when the vehicle came to a stop, all impact the outcome of the crash.
The vulnerability of those who use our roadways makes it critical for the authorities, motor vehicle operators, and pedestrians themselves to take steps to ensure their safety.
It's all a part of creating what is called a traffic-friendly environment, making provisions and instituting certain safety mechanisms, such as calculating the time span between stoplight changes to give vulnerable users more time to cross.
You will have, say, 1 to 1.25 meters per second you calculate for an average person to get across the road, where there is deemed to be a high number of vulnerable road users. Children, elderly, the blind, the disabled, you reduce it to, say, 0.75 meters per second. So you do the calculation, and then you always have a safety factor that you put into it, maybe 25% additional time provided to get pedestrians across.
It's important that all those who use the roads outside of the relative safety of a motor vehicle be considered. So, of course, there are provisions made for the elderly, the deaf, the visually impaired, and other physically challenged individuals.
A traffic-friendly environment for the person itself now. Sidewalks, pedestrian guardrails, pedestrian crossings, having ramps on the sidewalks themselves to provide ease of access. Advanced features in sidewalks, or you might have tactile sidewalks now where the texture of the sidewalk is different from the regular sidewalk for the blind, so that they can feel when they walk to know that right here is where I should cross. You can have audible pedestrian traffic signals now. For example, there was a pilot done by the Halfway Tree Transport Center, where when it's your time to walk, you'll actually hear a beep sound. So again, the blind can pick up that it's time for me now to cross this corridor.
Children too are considered in drafting the road code for vulnerable users, which serves as a guide to policymakers. It includes placing crossing guides and traffic wardens in school zones.
If the elderly is having problem crossing at the junction or intersection, anybody who is around and who notices it should go and assist them to cross the road by holding their hand and going across the road with them. And this also applies to the children. And in so doing, we'll be reducing the amount of people that get killed by vehicles.
Because of incorrect driving, road infringement, persons failing to apply the road code, approximately 57% of all road accidents and fatalities are caused by this incorrect driving.
Drivers, pedal cyclists, and motorcyclists also need to look out for pedestrians while on their journey. There are certain rules they need to obey for both their safety and that of the pedestrians, like being vigilant, avoiding the use of cellular phones and other electronic devices, cutting their speed, and overtaking only when necessary.
Pedestrians can do a lot to ensure that they use the road safely.
Like remembering the 6 steps to use when crossing the road and using them always. Think, is it safe to cross here? Can I see clearly? And can I be seen clearly? Stop. Once you have decided to cross, stop at that spot. Look and listen. Look left and right and listen to see if traffic is approaching. Wait. Ensure the road is fully clear. Cross. Proceed briskly and carefully to the other side. And keep looking and listening. While crossing, look and listen to see if there is any approaching traffic. Some other useful guidelines include wearing light-colored clothing at night. This will allow you to be more clearly seen by other road users. Always walk on the right side of the road towards the oncoming traffic. Make full use of pedestrian crossings, signalized crossing intersections, overhead bridges, and other crossing aids as much as possible. Never cross at deep corners where you cannot see vehicles approaching on either side. In areas where there is little or no sidewalk, walk as close as possible to the curb to prevent being hit and avoid being distracted by electronic devices. It takes the commitment of everyone working together to ensure all users of the road are granted safe passage. Remember, paying attention to road safety saves time, it saves money, and it saves lives.
A recap of the major news stories of the week next.
Hi there, I'm Simone Wolf with your JIS News of the Week. Prime Minister Portia Simpson-Miller this week called for greater dialogue and constructive engagement to secure progress and prosperity for the people of Jamaica, Cuba, and the rest of the Caribbean. She was speaking in Havana, where she participated in a ceremony to honor Cuban liberator and hero, Lieutenant General Antonio Maceo, and contributed to the fifth summit of the heads of government of CARICOM and Cuba. At Monday's summit, Mrs. Simpson-Miller and other CARICOM leaders renewed their call on the United States to end its economic embargo against Cuba. On Tuesday, the Economic Program Oversight Committee, EPOC, expressed optimism that Jamaica's economy could see positive growth and maintain minimal inflation for the final quarter of 2014.
Looks to me like the drought is broken. Looks to me like we are poised to have a good tourism season, so we can keep our fingers crossed that we'll regain some ground in the December quarter.
The EPOC co-chair said Jamaica's economy stood to benefit if the recent dramatic fall in oil prices was sustained over the next 12 to 18 months. Parliament has passed the first supplementary estimates, which shows that expenditure for the 2014-2015 fiscal year now stands at $539.3 billion. This reflects a $739 million reduction. Among other things, the supplementary estimates made provision for $160 million in additional expenditure for cleanup activities and repair to garbage trucks.
There was an emergency drought response, of which required an additional $106 million. Maintenance of roadways, $360 million. Settlement of outstanding arrears from government departments to the National Water Commission, some $215 million.
There were also provisions to meet outstanding bills by Tax Administration Jamaica to support the Jamaica Urban Transit Company and to facilitate the National Health Emergency Response Program. On Wednesday, government signed a Memorandum of Understanding with the UN Office on Drugs and Crime, UNODC, to join an international project to fight drug trafficking and reduce illicit imports and exports through international airports. The Airport Communication Project, AirCop, aims at intercepting illicit shipments by establishing real-time operational communication between international airports in Africa, Latin America, and the Caribbean.
It is accepted that Jamaica has made tremendous strides in the fight against international trade in illicit goods and drugs. This initiative will certainly provide us with some of the support needed to mount an even stronger response.
A new policy for the treatment of persons in police lockups and other detention facilities may be implemented early in 2015. The new administration policy for persons deprived of their liberty has been submitted for cabinet approval. It was drafted by a subcommittee of cabinet established in August to review the detention system. The secretariat of the subcommittee is meanwhile putting together a report of recommendations coming out of three working groups formed from that committee. The report is to be submitted to cabinet by the end of this year. Government has set aside $1 million to reward schools showing academic improvement and innovation from the use of the tablet computers being issued under the Tablets in Schools pilot project.
We're going to put aside a sum of $500,000. And those schools that come out on top, each of them will get $100,000 to show that the tablets are working.
The other $500,000 will be used as prize money for a competition in schools to select a top boy and girl who create applications with their tablets. And government has tabled legislation in Parliament that will make the Jamaica Anti-Doping Commission an independent legal body. When it's passed, the Anti-Doping in Sport Act 2014 should facilitate Jamaica's compliance with the revised World Anti-Doping Agency WADA code that comes into effect on January 1, 2015.
This bill seeks to repeal the Anti-Doping in Sport Act of 2008 and make new provisions for anti-doping in sport in order to align Jamaica's anti-doping legislation with the revised World Anti-Doping Code and international standards, which will come in force in January 1, 2015.
In the meantime, Prime Minister Portia Simpson-Miller extended congratulations and pledged government's continued support of Alia Atkinson in the wake of her recent history-making swim at the FINA World Swimming Championships in Qatar.
Alia, the entire nation of Jamaica is proud of you. Women across the world are beaming with pride. People around the globe hail you as an inspiration. Your country salutes you. I am very proud of you.
On Saturday, December 6, Alia became the joint world record holder for the 100-meter breaststroke. And those were some of the stories making news this week. I'm Simone Wolf.
The Passport Immigration and Citizenship Agency, PICA, wishes to advise the public that renunciation of Jamaican citizenship can only be done by submitting an application to this agency. Under the Jamaican Nationality Act, only the minister under whose portfolio the agency falls has the authority to approve a renunciation. Jamaican citizenship cannot be renunciated by merely submitting a letter certified by a Justice of the Peace, Notary Public, or other public official. Individuals seeking to give up their citizenship must submit written proof of their assumed nationality in the form of a citizenship certificate, passport, or an official letter of assurance or promise of nationality by a foreign state to PICA. Application forms and further information on citizenship renunciation may be accessed on the agency's website at www.pica.gov.jm.
And that's it for today's magazine program. Remember to make safety your priority and philanthropy a virtue. Keep the link. Tell us what you thought of the show. Send an email to jamaicamagazine@jis.gov.jm or hit us up on Twitter at JIS News. Also, click on our website, jis.gov.jm, for the latest government information. On behalf of the entire team here at the JIS, I'm Adrian Atkinson, reminding you to join us again tomorrow for more information you can use. Until then, do take care. Thanks for watching, and all good.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.